In this video, you will learn about two fairly new ocean technologies, ocean current and wave energy. Since these are not yet mature developed technologies, we won't go into as much detail as the other technologies discussed this week. Since this is our last lecture about ocean technology, I would like to mention two other ocean technologies that did not make our list, but still need to be acknowledged. First, there is a thermal energy conversion technology that uses temperature difference in different layers of the sea. A second technology converts energy that is present at locations where salt water mixes with fresh water. The salinity gradient between fresh and salt water creates an osmotic pressure difference, which can be converted into electrical energy. Let's really start this lecture with the ocean current technology. The ocean current is caused by different factors like the wind, the temperature difference in the ocean, depth variations, and seismic events. The flow of water carries a large amount of kinetic energy that can be converted by turbines. In essence, the working principle of the water turbine is similar to that of wind turbines. The primary energy potential calculation is therefore the same as that of the wind energy potential. Consequently, the power potential, P current, is equal to half the density multiplied by the surface area of the rotor and the velocity to the power 3. The power potential in a water flow with respect to a similar wind flow is much larger since water has a much higher density than air. Since the ocean current technology is still in its experimental phase, the conversion efficiency of an ocean current system is still subject of discussion. However, its energy conversion steps are quite similar to that of a wind turbine, only underwater. It's therefore a good exercise for you to take some time and revise what we have learned this week. Which loss mechanisms do you think affect the conversion efficiency of a power generation system that uses ocean current technology? What practical issues will influence the energy yield of such a system? The ocean water is always moving and therefore the current is continuous. There are, however, fluctuations in the velocity of the ocean current. These fluctuations mainly depend on the wind and the temperature difference that are a result of weather and seasonal variations. Let's do a small design calculation together. We will imagine a turbine with a diameter of 20 meters and an ocean current velocity of 1.5 meters per second, which is below average for the Gulf Stream. We'll use a power coefficient of 0.3, which is quite a conservative estimation compared to wind turbines. The ocean water density is 1025 kg per cubic meter. The turbine diameter gives us a rotor surface area of over 300 square meters, and this results in an output power of 163 kilowatt. A big advantage of ocean current energy is that it provides a continuous source of energy. Additionally, water is more than 800 times as heavy as air, and a similar flow therefore contains a lot more kinetic energy. However, challenges include corrosion, reliability issues, and algae growth, which can result in high maintenance costs. Furthermore, underwater turbines will impact the marine life. Let's move on to a more developed technology, wave energy. The kinetic energy in the wind causes wave to form at the surface of the ocean water. Such a surface wave contains both potential and kinetic energy. Many different concepts have been designed to convert the energy from surface wave to electrical energy. This picture shows six of these concepts that all use the same basic energy conversion principle. We will focus on the second concept, which is known as a surface attenuator. An example of a surface attenuator is the Pylamis wave energy converter. By floating on the waves, this machine converts the energy in the wave into mechanical energy and subsequently into electrical energy. We'll use the potential energy of the wave to derive the primary energy potential. If you consider this image, where the waves has been simplified as a sinusoidal waveform. Here the zero is the average surface level, h is the height difference, and t is the wavelength. The effective mass of the wave is equal to the product of the volume of the upper part of the wave indicated by the dark blue area and the density of the ocean water. This water mass will fall down over height h and therefore produce energy. This is represented by the familiar equation of the potential energy. Energy is mass times gravity constant times height. If we take the mass flow instead of the mass, we can obtain the primary power potential. The mass flow is a function of the water density, the horizontal speed of the wave, the height h, and the length of the wave perpendicular to its direction L. However, since L depends on the length of the device that converts the energy, it is common to depict the primary potential of the wave as power per unit length. We can now obtain the following expression for the primary power potential per unit length. This power, which is equal to the kinetic power, is a quarter of the density multiplied by the gravitational constant, the height difference squared, and the horizontal velocity. I strongly encourage you to derive this formula for yourself and see if you come up with the same equation. Since the efficiency depends on the type of system used, each conversion method has some unique conversion losses. However, roughly speaking, each system will have mechanical conversion losses caused by the interaction of the waves with the hydraulic chambers. Additionally, some electrical losses will be present due to the operation of the generator and other power electronics. The changing magnitude of the wind force will mainly cause the fluctuations in energy yield. Ocean wave conversion technology has a capacity factor of around 35%. Let's go through a calculation. This map shows a part of the Atlantic Ocean between North America and Europe. We can gather that the highest waves occur around the North Sea. Let's take a moderate estimate at this location. A wave speed of 11 meters per second and a height of 5 meters occur. From this we can calculate the potential energy, which amounts 691 kilowatt per meter. The main advantages of wave energy are its predictable character and low operational costs. However, it's a technology with high investment costs. Ocean wave technology has some other inherent challenges, such as environmental effects, the obstruction of sea travel, and the unavailability of suitable locations. Let's look at wave energy from the world's perspective. In 2016, the global installed capacity was 1.1 megawatt. According to the capacity factor of 35%, the global energy yield is 3.37 gigawatt hour. If we take a world population of 7.5 billion people, this results in a global yield of about 0.45 watt hours per person per day. However, it has been predicted that the total potential could reach to 29,500 terawatt hours per year. Let's take a look at the map that shows the area required to cover the world's electricity demand with a single renewable energy technology in 2040. The potential power density of a wave is around 20 to 30 kilowatt per meter of coastline. Therefore, 168,000 kilometers of coastline is required to meet global demand. This means that there isn't enough energy potential available to meet the global demand. There are a lot of differences between renewable energy technologies. Each technology has its own characteristics and advantages. For example, both ocean current and wave energy technology can provide a continuous source of power. In the next video, we will compare all renewable energy generation technologies discussed in this week.